and one strike to Chipper Jones. Total bases in the National League. Chipper's there. In fact, you look at all the major categories, and Chipper's in the hunt from top to bottom. He hasn't had a spectacular year, but has been extremely solid. Line drive, left field, one hop, and over for a two-base hit. But Chipper Jones picked up another double, his second against the Reds in the series, his 39th of the year. And he's in scoring position with no one out here in the sixth.
Third time in six innings, the Braves have been able to put the leadoff man on base, this time on second base with a double. Sweet swing from both sides of the plate. His number is almost identical this year, George. He's made some adjustments, and Chipper Jones, boy, he's having maybe his biggest year ever.
And you can't forget about him. He's stolen 18 with a left-hander, Valone. Uh-oh, towards the alley. This will get him home easily. Jordan rounds first, heads to second, and will cruise with a two-base hit.
Fastball, fastball. Looks like one of those nicer. Ron Valone really doesn't have a good feel of his off-speed pitch, so he's gone with his number one. Forced it perhaps, but certainly has made some mistakes with it. And back-to-back very good fastball hitters in Chipper Jones. You have to tip your hat sometimes to the hitter, but boy, when you lay that baby down the middle, some mistake pitches there too.
That'll get Scott Sullivan up and throwing for the Reds.
Well, Brian Jordan, we've seen the last couple of nights how he has shortened his swing, just trying to make solid contact, and he's strong enough that he gets a ball right there, he's going to hurt you.
Here's Andrew. Bounced to second, walk, stole a base in the fourth. Off second after his 26th double, knocked in a run that makes it 3-1. That's now 102 runs batted in for Brian Jordan. There's right-hander Scott Sullivan. Reds bullpen now, of course, has White and Reyes from the left side. Graves, Williamson, Belinda, Sullivan from the right side. And remember, Brett Tomko's down there too with Parrish back and in the rotation. Tomko in the bullpen, at least until the Chicago series, where he'll start one of the doubleheader games. Chris, it's interesting, too. Last night, he pitched well coming out of the bullpen. Two good innings, aggressive, came right at the hitters, and maybe a couple outings like that will be enough to jumpstart him and get him on a roll again.
Well, you certainly would hope so. I mean, this ball club needs pitching. Going down the stretch, you've got a doubleheader coming up. His big start coming up on Tuesday is very important, not only to him, but the ball club.
2-1, Andrew Jones. That's out of play, and it's 2-2.
And while I say that, George, about it, Brett Tomko's upcoming start, we've said the same thing about maybe this will get him going about a half a dozen times this year. Once when he was sent down to the minor leagues, he was challenged, came back, pitched well after pitching well in Indianapolis. Same thing happened when he was sent down to the bullpen. Came back, pitched very well in the bullpen, so he got some good starts after that, but hasn't been able to keep the consistency at the level that he needs to.
2-2 from Valone. For the game today, and talking with Juan Guzman, who's become kind of a tutor of Brett Tomko in the last couple of weeks, I asked him, I said, what does Brett Tomko need to get over that hump? And he said, really, I look at him and I think of me. I was immature at times. I didn't understand what I needed to do mentally to be a successful pitcher. And he said, it's going to come, and only he knows when it'll come. Astute observation from Guzman. Banged into left. There's a base hit. Here comes Jordan to the plate. The throw won't be in time. It's cut. They've got a shot for Jones, but he's back. Base hit by Andrew. 79 runs batted in, and it's now 4-1 Atlanta.
Well, Brian Jordan read that ball perfectly right off the bat. Knew it was going to be a base hit. Got a big jump on it. Comes around to score. Not a big outing for Ron Valone tonight. Got to be a little bit disappointed. Take a look at Jordan right here. The third base coach, Ed Yost, he's got his hands up. Stay right there, Brian. Stay right there. Running the stop sign. He beats the throw by a long shot.
That'll be it for Valone. So while the pitching change takes place, we'll take time out for these messages. You're watching Reds Baseball on Fox Sports Net, Ohio.
It's about summer and drive.
Well, the go-to guy in the Reds bullpen in there again, this time for the 62nd time, 4-3 on the year, is Scott Sullivan. He has saved the Reds so many times, coming in the middle of the ball game, holding the opposition right there, only to see his ball club battle back into it. Hopefully that will be the story tonight.
Jones on first, still no one out. Here's Jose Hernandez. Hernandez strikeout and a fly ball to center. Atlanta, 4 runs, 6 hits. The runner at first, Vallone's responsibility. The Reds a run and 5 hits. There's the line at this moment on Ron Vallone. There's the teacher and the teachee. Guzman and Tomko. Say, Chris.
You know, interesting, George. I don't mean to interrupt, but interesting the comments that you say Juan Guzman made about Brett Tomko. That's after not knowing Brett Tomko all that very long. And pretty much right on the money.
They've spent a lot of time together. Tomko's taken some tapes back to his apartment. Guzman sat and viewed them, not once, not twice, but on a regular basis. Guzman's been a good addition to this staff, and you look ahead towards the year 2000, you think he'd be a great addition there too. The question is, he's a free agent at the end of the year. Guzman said very clearly he wants to stay in Cincinnati. He said he's more comfortable here than any place he's ever been. The problem is, it's going to be a big price tag on him as a free agent at the end of the season. He's making $5 million now.
And it's not going to go down.
Mm-hmm. Does it ever? Two balls, one strike to Hernandez. That's a base hit to center. Jones will stop at second. And the hit parade continues. Two doubles, two singles. 4-1 lead for Atlanta already. And there are two runners on, still no one out. And Brian Hunter coming to the plate. Jack McKee and Don Gullett hoping for some offense against Mulholland tonight. They've gotten hits, but only one run. And hoping for a deep performance from Ron Vallone. They haven't gotten that. And they're trailing 4-1. Here's Hunter, grounded to short and walked. Baseball on Fox Sports Net Ohio being brought to you tonight by your local Mercury dealers. Imagine yourself in a Mercury now. Uh-oh, deep left. Vaughn just can turn and watch it go. Bangs it off the back wall. A three-run shot from Brian Hunter. Just like that, it's a 7-1 ball game. So much for keeping it close. Now lead it 7-1.
Boy, a jubilant Braves dugout there. Lots of high fives going around, handshakes, headbutts, and everything else. I'll tell you what, the Reds have seen way too much of that this year out of that ball club.
Brett Boone, a two-run home run in the third. That was off Ron Vallone. And here in the sixth, the three-run home run by Hunter. One of those runs charged against Vallone, so he's charged with 5 runs, 6 hits. Struck out 3, walked 4. Aaron Boone throws out Eddie Perez, and that's finally the first out of the inning.
Well, it was the sixth inning last night that it was really put on ice with a big three spot. Right there is a two spot by Brian Hunter right down the line it goes. That was a three-run home run, and a shot it was. Brian, we talked about him being a good fastball hitter out over the plate, and that's what he got from Sullivan. Boy, talk about a guy that has rejuvenated his career. Part-time player and very, very part-time player when he was here with the Reds. He went down to the Atlanta Braves, lost some weight, worked on his conditioning, become a student of hitting, and he has fashioned himself a pretty doggone nice major league career.
Hey, Chris, you know, it looks simple when you look at there's George Fabregas and Greg Myers right behind Hunter, but Hunter was originally drafted by the Braves. He was projected as a big star, hit over 300 in the minor leagues a couple of times, and they didn't like his attitude. Bobby Cox, with the ball club at that time, did not like what he saw. He left, went to the Pittsburgh Pirates. The Reds acquired him from Pittsburgh at maybe the low point of his career. And the Reds, after releasing him, then reacquired him for Indianapolis. And then he started his comeback, got his weight down, and give Bobby Cox credit because he gave him a second chance. He studied exactly what he'd been doing and was impressed by the fact that he was serious about the game of baseball again. And you and I were talking about it last night off the air. I mean, he's in the best shape he's ever been in his career. And you have to give Brian Hunter a lot of credit for coming back, not just to be in the major leagues, but mentally, physically, and emotionally to get where he is after almost throwing away his career. That's a great example of Bobby Cox, too, giving a guy a second chance. Bobby Cox will not have somebody on his roster unless he believes he's a team player and will contribute. The old Brian Hunter wouldn't have been on the Braves.
You're right.
And he's always been able to put a lick on a fastball.
How about Terry Mulholland hustling out that ground ball right there? He's been robbed a couple times by Pokey Reese.
Last time, Reese's play was spectacular. This, just a good one above average. And they get Mulholland for the second out down at first, two away. In the Mets-Astros game, Astros score a run. It's 3-2 now. Fourth inning. Mets lead it. Right now, Jack McKee not worried about the Astros. He's worried about being six runs down to Atlanta. With a relatively fresh bullpen sitting out there for the Braves. Soft liner to Boone. Got it. And Gerald Williams is 0-for-3 in a walk. But the damage done by Brian Hunter. Three-run home run. It's now 7-1 Atlanta. Sean Casey is 1-for-1 in a walk due to lead it off. Three-run home run. It's now 7-1 Atlanta. Sean Casey is 1-for-1 in a walk due to lead it off. Here we go to the bottom of six. The numbers for the Reds, a run, five hits. Sean Casey has one of them. Reds got three hits in the first inning. Casey's single, the third consecutive single, knocked in the Reds' run, made it 1-0 Cincinnati back then. Then Vaughn bounced into a double play, and Dimitri Young bounced out. The inning was over. Reds have threatened in every inning but one, but the Braves have turned three double plays, 3-6-4-3 twin killings. Mulholland hasn't given in to Casey all night. Gave up a single in the first, walked him in the third, but he's still staying down and away to Sean. In for a strike, 3-1. Casey took a hop, skip, and was heading to first, but Jeff Kellogg said, that's a strike, and it's 3-2. Does he throw the breaking ball again? 3-2. He threw it 3-1. Here's ball four. Hey, don't forget, before it's time to hit the books again, hit the ballpark. for Reds College Night, Friday, September the 10th. Reds meet the Marlins, 7:05. All college students and their dates or spouses may purchase half-price box or reserve seats in advance of game day. Get your College Night tickets at the Reds Advance Ticket Window, all Ticketmaster outlets, by phone at 513-421-REDS or online at www.cincinnatireds.com. Here's Greg Vaughn, bounced into a double play and struck out. Jeff Bagwell's 39th home run, a solo shot to center field in the fourth off Octavio Dotel, has made it Mets 3 and Houston 2. Vaughn to center, hit pretty good. Jones, warning track, wall, and he's got it. Well, that's the difference. There's about a 50-foot difference either side of center field. One spot it'll carry out, that spot it'll kind of die, and that one kind of died.
Well, right now the flags are completely limp, no wind at all. When Brett Boone hit his ball, there was wind blowing in from the flags, but that causes that swirl effect and actually makes the ball carry better. So Vaughn had to hit this ball with a little more muscle to get it out of here if he's going out to the biggest part of the ballpark. The reaction by Mulholland tells you this. He thinks it's out of here, looking for a new baseball. Hey, turn around, Andrew's got one for you.
He's pleasantly surprised, as Vaughn was unpleasantly surprised.
You know, the Reds don't have to make up their deficit all in one inning. A little bit here, a little bit there. All of a sudden, you get something going and the momentum. At this stage in the ballpark, tough break.
One away and a 1-1 count to Dimitri Young, who's one for two, a single to center. He was hoping, the eyes were hoping, but it fell about 5 feet short, about 395 feet away. Dimitri to right, pretty good towards the corner. In the corner against the wall is Jordan, and there's two away. Brian Jordan hauls it in, and there are two outs.
Well, there's an old baseball pitching axiom that says pitch to the dimensions of your ballpark, and boy, Terry Mulholland has done that perfectly in this inning. Andrew Jones right to the 404 mark in dead center field, and that time Brian Jordan right against the wall and right.
Six-run lead allows you to do that too. Casey still at first now with two outs though. And this early in a ball game, still the six. You don't have to just think round trippers. You need base runners. And this one will be in the air also. Boone back, Jordan in, Jordan calling. Got it, and the Reds will strand a runner, their fifth. So the leadoff walk doesn't do Cincinnati any good this inning. To the seventh we go, 7-1 Braves.
If they did it with a player having a great year. But, I mean, you take a look at a guy like Ernie Banks, who's never went to the World Series but was an MVP. I mean, obviously, he had some seasons there that warranted MVP status. So I think that, you know, the fact that you play on a team that is a playoff contender or a postseason team doesn't necessarily give you an edge over another guy that had a better year.
Jordan swings and misses. One ball. Two strikes last year, a good example of that. Sammy Sosa edged out Mark McGwire, largely more than anything because Sosa's team was in a pennant race and he produced in that pennant race. McGwire didn't unfortunately have the chance to do it. Sosa's numbers.
But you still, if you look at it, it was a contrived playoff format, the wild card, the one game playoff with the Giants in order to do it. He didn't, they weren't really in a pennant race, they were in a race for the wild card. So I'm still a little chapped over that vote, yes.
And two strikes to Jordan. And the bottom line is 4 weeks of baseball will really tell who will be the most valuable player. MVP comes at the end of the regular season. Pokey calling, he has it. Two away. I remember the strike year. Jeff Bagwell went out right before the strike. That's the year he broke his hand. And the way it turned out, of course, there was no postseason anyways. Really didn't mean anything. But Bagwell had hoped to get back for the end of the year. As it was, he would not have been in the lineup for his club the final 6 weeks of the season anyways. Hopefully, we never have to deal with that again at the tail end of the season. Andrew Jones. 1-for-2, single walk, stolen base, and there's his second hit. Chipper Jones will stop at second. Here's a great example, Chris. Andrew Jones, Chipper Jones, content to take base hits, even though they're leading 7-1, comfortable, they've now got 10 hits. Reds, who need base hits, swinging from their heels last inning.
Yeah, you're absolutely right, George. Good level swing by Chipper Jones and Andrew Jones. Good professional hitters will take what the pitcher gives them.
Do the little things, get on base, and get a rally started. Two on, two out. Here's Jose Hernandez. 1-for-3, a single and a run scored. Loop towards right. It'll reach the seats, be out of play. San Francisco beat Philadelphia 5-3. Pittsburgh over Colorado 9-8. Those finals. Milwaukee leads L.A. 5-0 in the seventh. Mets now score again. They lead 4-3 in the top of the fifth inning. Now another run scored. 5-3 Mets over Houston. Top of the fifth. So that one's a seesaw affair tonight. Cardinals are leading Florida 3-0 in the fifth. The further scoring in that game. Robert Ventura scored John Olerud to make it 4-3. And then Sean Dunston knocked in Mike Piazza to make it 5-3. In that St. Louis game, Cardinals now lead at 4-0. Big Mac, Mark McGuire's hit his 52nd. Trying to close the gap with Sammy Sosa. Kevin McClinchy, the right-hander. Mike Remlinger, the left-hander. There's a weakness on this Braves team right now. It's in the right side of that bullpen. Rocker and Remlinger from the left side. They lost Rudy Cienez with a stress fracture to his elbow. They hope to get him back in a couple of weeks. Sky to center. Hammond's under it. He has it. The Braves strand two. They've stranded five, but where it counts, they've got a 7-up. 7-1 Atlanta. Hammond's goes to the bat rack. LaRue in the pitcher spot to follow. Holland outstanding so far. 6 innings, 5 hits, 1 run for the left-hander. Brett Boone, the former Red, has contributed 2-for-3. A walk and his 17th home run. That gave Atlanta a 2-1 lead. Since then, Brian Hunter's chipped in with a 3-run home run. That's made it 7-1. Sean Casey, an RBI single in the first, and has also walked twice. That's the only Reds run. A run, 5 hits for Cincinnati, 7 runs, 10 hits for the Braves. So, Reds have some work to do as we go to the bottom of the seventh. They've got 3 more cracks at Mulholland and the bullpen. Walt Weiss into the game at short. So it's Chipper Jones at third. Walt Weiss, your shortstop. Brett Boone at second. Hunter at first. Perez behind the plate for Mulholland. That's a base hit. Second hit of the ball game for Jeffrey Hammonds, and he's on for the third time. 2 hits and a walk. He continues to deliver in place of Mike Cameron. That'll bring up Jason LaRue, the catcher.
Big sweeping swing for Jeffrey Hammonds. He gets way out there and hooks that ball. You know, that's the way he really likes to hit it. Not very often do you see Jeffrey Hammonds drive the ball all that much to right field. His power is from really right center on over towards the left field line.
Here's LaRue and the 1-ball delivery to him. Down to third, but foul. With the pitcher due up next, Mark Lewis has come into the on-deck circle, and in the bullpen, left-hander Dennis Reyes is starting to loosen. Meanwhile, Kevin McClinchy and Mike Remlinger keep loosening on their own in the bullpen for the Braves. We talked about it at the start. Basically, Mulholland, a 6-inning pitcher. He's into the seventh now, so any sign of a crack in the armor, and Bobby Cox will go to his pen. Braves start the night. 3.5 ahead of the Mets. Reds a game and a half back of Houston. Towards the hole, that'll be through. Back-to-back hits. Well, it's like Dennis Menke and Ken Griffey and the rest of the Reds on the bench told the Reds, what we were talking about, Chris, look, just take what they give you. We need some runners, not just home runs.
Well, Jason, we were really fortunate with some of the defensive positioning that Braves play against him. Chipper Jones hugging the line, almost got the foul ball fair to lead the inning off. That would have been bad for LaRue, but this time the cut fastball that he got in there finds a hole for a base hit, and that'll bring Bobby Cox out of the dugout.
And Kevin McClinchy into the game. While the pitching change takes place, he'll take time out for these messages. You're watching Reds Baseball on Fox Sports Net, Ohio. Eat smart, travel light, save big. It's at Subway. Remember to help Cincinnati save 24 million fat grams by enjoying one of seven delicious Subway sandwiches with 6 grams of fat or less. Just check the back of your Reds ticket and cashiers stub in for a mouth-watering low-fat sub. Plus, swing by any Subway before September 5th and register to win a fabulous trip for two to Kauai. All winners are local.
So you see me going around after the ball games looking for ticket stubs, huh?
My secret Subway
is out.
Subs.
I'll turn them into Subways any day. Kevin McClinchy, nothing Subway about him. Right over the top, hard-throwing right-hander. He was in the ballgame last night, and he'll face a familiar face. Left-handed hitting Mark Sweeney.
Sweeney batting for Mark Lewis. First pitch swinging, dunks it into left. Back is Weiss. It drops. The runners had to hold. The bases will be loaded. Well, not the swing that Sweeney wanted, but it produced. Bases loaded on the base hit to left by Mark Sweeney. What a way to come back from Indianapolis. Same way he left, hitting base hits.
Well, not quite as dramatic as his first hit of the season, which was a 3-run home run. But this time he gets it right in no man's land there. It's one of those situations where the infielder going out, the outfielder coming in, both feel each other's presence and kind of peel off.
Three straight hits. The Reds showing some life, trailing by six. Here's Pokey Reese. No one out. Reese, infield hit. Walk and strikeout. Foul back and out of play for strike one. Right now, the numbers on Terry Mulholland. He goes 6-plus innings. Allows one run and 7 hits. Two of the runners on base are his responsibility. This crowd starting to rustle around a bit, showing some energy. Down and away for a ball. Sit and watch after those pretty impressive numbers. Pokey waits him out to 3-1. McClinchy pitched an inning last night, gave up a hit, struck out two. The Reds trying to get him with a second look at him in back-to-back nights. 3-1, fans on their feet. That's ball four, it'll force in a run. Second run for the Reds, it's now 7-2, bases still loaded. When the year started, McClinchy was almost exclusively a fastball pitcher out of the bullpen. Last night he used his slider a couple of times. So far, they've been behind, not using it tonight.
Well, he had a big lead last night, and he seemed to get some more strikes early in the count. But when you fall behind with your fastball, you have a tendency not to experiment and try to throw that breaking ball until you get a strike or two in there.
Well, here comes Barry, the Reds captain tonight. Single, fly ball to right, and a bouncer to second. Bases loaded. This brings up two parts of the Barry Larkin saga. He's gone over 6,000 at-bats without a Grand Slam home run. And he's gone 64 games without a home run this year. One swing of the bat like that, and the Reds could be back in this one big time. Strike one to Barry. With a stretch, McClinchy tries to check it, and it's 0-2.
Boy, that that's the explosiveness of McClinchy fastball right there. Larkin looking for something that he needs to turn on, and he had to get that bat going a little bit early because he knows McClinchy gets it up there in a hurry. That ball just exploded, came up and inside on him, and all tied him up.
Listen to the fans and the chant for Barry. Line drive, right field, base hit, one run scores. Sweeney will be held. He slips and falls, but he gets back to the bag in time. He was trying to score from the get-go, was surprised when he finally saw Ron Oster, who held him up, and he luckily got back to the bag. Larkin delivers. The Reds have made it a 7-3 game, and Cox will be out to the mound.
Larkin, the 0-2 pitch, not a good idea by McClinchy, a fastball out over the plate. Larkin does that his whole career, and Bobby Cox, he's getting his work in, coming out to the mound again.
Well, it's the new Red, Sean Casey, against the ex-Red, Mike Remlinger, when we return. While the pitching change takes place, we'll take time out for these messages. You're watching Reds Baseball on Fox Sports Net, Ohio. 0-3. Bounced into a double play, struck out, and hit one to the wall in center field his last time up.
He's had pretty good numbers against Remlinger in his career. You see there, 500 batting average with a home run, 4-for-8 total.
7-4 Atlanta. Stays away, and it's 0-2.
Nasty pitch right there after a four-seam fastball to start. A little two-seamer that darts away from Vaughn. We know that Remlinger's got a good arm, and he has excelled in his situation in Atlanta this year.
Reese off third with two away. Reds have put three home here in the seventh. He held on it. The changeup that he wanted down and away, and got it right about where he did want it.
How about that? Embracing the Braves philosophy in a big way right there. How many times did you see Mike Remlinger throw an 0-2 changeup in a Reds uniform?
It got him with the fastball. 92 miles of heat. Beats Greg Vaughn, but the Reds make it a game. 7-4 as they get three in the seventh. Here we go to the eighth.
This will be the third pitcher of the night for the Reds. 61st time for Danny. 8-6 on the year with 18 saves, a 3.1 earned run average. And the Reds down by three. Got to hold them right there.
Scott Sullivan did get three outs to end the sixth, but before he did, he gave up the three-run home run to Brian Hunter. And right now, that's the difference in the ballgame, 7-4. Ballone went five plus innings, six hits, five runs. Two of the runs were charged to Sullivan. Aaron Boone scoops it up. Brian Hunter retired. Last time up, he ripped his sixth home run. This time, Danny Graves gets him. Our Ohio Lottery winning numbers for tonight on late draw. Pick 3, 980, 980. Pick 4, 1960, 1960. Super Lotto, 4, 31, 34, 38, 39, 46. 4, 31, 34, 38, 39, 46. Hope you had a winner tonight in the Ohio Lottery. One away, here's Eddie Perez. Double fly ball out and ground ball to third. Eddie homered last night and hit a solid double to lead off the third. Scored ahead of Boone's home run in the third. Hey, time to fire up those grills with a delicious taste of JTM's new grillers, choice beef, or Italian sausage patties, or JTM's hamburgers and boneless pork ribs. A brand you can count on, JTM. He's got it, two away. Well, Rob Butcher. pitcher, and the PR department confirmed what we were saying, Chris. This is the first time this year the Reds have hit into four double plays, and the four turned by the Braves, a season high for them. It's come on the right night for Atlanta, the wrong night for Cincinnati. Meanwhile, the Mets get three in the fifth and now lead the Astros 6-3. Bottom of five at the Astrodome. Roger Cedeno singled in Robin Ventura for the third of the three runs. One ball, two strikes to Mike. On the year, 0-1. That'll kick away from LaRue. He'll have to hustle, and he gets him. 1-2-3 for Graves. A couple of ground outs and the strikeout. Reds go right back to work. It's a three-run ball game, and Dimitri Young will lead it off. The bottom of eight. The closer, John Rocker, is rocking and dealing in the bullpen. So after being well rested, he's ready. Dimitri Young, Aaron Boone, and Hammonds due up 5, 6, and 7 for the Reds. Couldn't ask for more than you got from Mike Remlinger, Chris.
Oh, he came in a tough situation. Bases loaded, nobody out. He did about best anybody could do. Beyond striking out the side, came in and got Sean Casey, the hottest hitter in the Reds ball club right now, to ground into a double play. That did bring a run in, but when he got out of the inning on the next batter, by blowing away Greg Vaughn, he showed that he has still got his pretty good arm, and one of the reasons why he is a candidate for the pitcher of the month.
Well, Weiss tosses out Dimitri Young, and there's one away here in the eighth inning. In the Reds bullpen, Scott Williamson is loosening. Boone comes to the plate. He is hit into one of those four double plays. Strikeout, fly ball out on the DP ground ball. There's Williamson. Reds baseball on Fox Sports Net Ohio, brought to you by the new Dodge. Stop by and see the winning lineup of cars, trucks, minivans, and SUVs at the friendly Dodge dealer near you. Don't forget off day tomorrow for the Reds. Then we go to Philadelphia.
You know, George, as you watch Mike Remlinger pitch, you can't help but think that perhaps he benefited from all the innings that he got last year. You know, he was a guy who was in and out of different roles as a major leaguer, back and forth, never really got on a consistent track where he got a whole bunch of starts in a row. But he became the opening day pitcher when Dave Burba was traded away, had a whole bunch of starts, and it's those kind of innings log that get you a feel for what your stuff is. And then you go over to the Braves and you surround yourself with guys like Tommy Glavine and Greg Maddux and other fine pitchers, you're going to obviously learn some more. So he has really blossomed into quite a fine left-handed pitcher.
He readily admits that his year last year in Cincinnati has helped him become even a better pitcher. He's matured so much, he's always had a lively arm. Boone slaps it foul. It stays at 1-2. Part of that maturity is baseball maturity. As you look at the numbers this year with National League leaders in earned run average for relief pitchers, Remlinger's right there. Reyes and Williamson, both under 2, and Remlinger just a little above. Oh, he hung that one, but Boone pops it foul.
Sometimes a high changeup more effective than a low changeup, especially when you hang one up above the eye level. Aaron Boone trying to do a little Tommy Hawking of his own.
The Braves are very happy with the work that Remlinger's come through this year, and being the iron-armed left-hander that he is, there's been some talk that he'll sign a multi-year deal to stay in Atlanta. That's the first time he'll have more than a one-year deal in his career. That helps you mature a little bit too.
Yes,
when you get to that point. One ball, two strikes. That's on the field and off the field. He and his wife Ronell, a baby boy Chance, and that changes your life a whole lot, doesn't it, Chris?
Don't we all know that?
A new perspective and a very good one. 1-2. Hit pretty good. Center field. Back goes Jones to the warning track. Forget about it. It's gone. answer.
Well, the Boone brothers go yard tonight. The number 10 for Aaron Boone as he goes almost to the identical spot that Brett did, at least in the same vicinity, the deepest part of the ballpark.
One out and a run in, and here's Hammonds, who's been on base three times. Make it four. Three singles and a walk for Jeffrey Hammonds. Now the tying run comes to the plate here in the eighth. Here's another look at Boone's 10th.
It was a breaking ball. Mike Remlinger threw a couple of changeups earlier in the count. This one in the wheelhouse. Boy, all eyes from that Atlanta dugout. You saw Andrew Jones go into that center field wall hard. It is padded here at Synergy Field, but there was nobody in that Braves dugout that moved until he finally got up. It took him a while.
Hammonds is on, one out, one run in, and here's Jason LaRue, one for three. He waves at one wide, and it's strike one.
That's a sinking fastball designed to get the ground ball.
Ryan Johnson has moved into the on-deck circle with a left-hander on the mound, Remlinger, and there is only a left-hander throwing. So either way, Johnson, if the inning stays alive, will face a left-hander. It off and it's 0-2. Well, most of the fireworks that have gone off at Synergy in this series the last two nights have been from the Braves. Finally, the Reds get to send some fireworks skyward with Aaron Boone's 10th home run. 0-2 to LaRue. Second. Well, on a night where the Reds have already hit into four double plays, the one thing you can say is it's very unlikely they'll hit into a fifth in this inning. Now, with the tying run at the plate and a sixth run out there at second base, the Reds dig in.
Ball really should have been blocked by Eddie Perez. That ball just got right by him. Tried to get his body down, but it went alongside of his glove.
Wild pitch charged against Remlinger.
Teasing Jason LaRue with that somewhat dead fish of a fastball that kind of dives away from him. Don't be surprised now with a man on second. He'll just go back to the heat that he blew Greg Vaughn away with.
Setting up away. A game that's seen Atlanta jump out to a 7-1 lead. The Reds got three in the seventh, one here in the eighth, and now they trail by only two. He got him. He kept working the outside and finally does punch him out. That's your second out of the inning, and here comes Brian Johnson. Well, this has been a 99 season where the Reds have got great support from their bench. They'll need it again.
Funny, when Mike Remlinger was over here in a Reds uniform, he thought his second best pitch after his fastball was his slider. Well, tonight he has shown that it is his changeup. He set Greg Vaughn up with a changeup and then blew the fastball by him. That time he set Jason LaRue up with a fastball and got the changeup by him.
Here comes John Rocker running in as the pitching change takes place. We'll take time out for these messages. You're watching Reds Baseball on Fox Sports Net, Ohio.
It's about summer and driving down the road, but most of all, it's coming to an end. It's about getting you into your choice of an award-winning Chrysler or Plymouth car or minivan before summer ends. About getting $1,000 introductory cash allowance on the new 2000 Plymouth Neon. On other select models, get low APRs or low lease rates. The Chrysler Plymouth Summer Clearance. It all ends soon. See your Chrysler Plymouth dealer today.
We all do dumb things. Paying too much for car insurance doesn't have to be one of them. Geico. A 15-minute call could save you 15% or more on car insurance. We all do dumb things. Paying too much for car insurance doesn't have to be one of them. Geico. A 15-minute call could save you 15% or more on car insurance.
In nature, things move for a reason. And if you're talking about the nature-loving Jeep Grand Cherokee, it's moving for some very good reasons. Because along with having more power, luxury, and capability than ever before, the 1999 Jeep Grand Cherokee Laredo now comes with a low $339 a month lease. So for a great offer on this award-winning vehicle, make your move today. Because this is an opportunity you don't want to miss. Check one out at your Jeep dealer.
In for the 63rd time on the year. 30 saves. He's the fourth Brave pitcher to notch 30 saves in a season. Joins Gene Garber, Mark Wohlers, and Kerry Leitenberg. And nothing pretty about this guy except his fastball right over the top. 90 miles an hour sometimes, sometimes harder. Got to turn it up a notch if you're going to catch up to it.
Here's Brian Johnson pinch hitting at 243. Four home runs, 16 runs batted in. Fouled off for strike one. A good fastball hitter, but the best you can say this year, rusty. He has not had the kind of at-bats that he had hoped for in 1999. Part of that due to the knee injury that put him on the disabled list for a while. Big at-bat here for him and the Reds. Hoffman with 33, Urbina and Wagner with 33, Nen and Rocker next with 30 saves. Line drive in the alley. That'll get a run home. It's 7-6. Big at-bat for Brian Johnson. Here he comes to second, and he's in there. With the tying run. Time and time again, we mentioned it, that the Reds bench has come through big, and this time it's Brian Johnson. This has been a year where you pick your hero each and every night. The Reds have come a long way back. They only trail by one now.
Well, Johnny Rocker got a fastball by him on a foul ball straight back the first pitch, but it's so he comes back with an off-speed pitch. And Brian Johnson thinking the same thing. And he lines it in the left center gap right there. That is a huge hit with two outs. Brings it to a one-run ball game. And he'll get a hearty congratulations as he goes back into the dugout with that hook slide first. Some high fives.
Now the tying runs at second. Jack McKeon takes Brian Johnson out after his seventh double. And in comes newly activated Kerry Robinson, who came up from Indianapolis. Robinson's a speed burner. He represents the tying run. What a baptism for Kerry Robinson as Pokey Reese steps to the plate. Reese, two walks, a single, and a strikeout tonight. By the way, Mets 7, Houston 3, top of 6 in Houston. Robinson, outstanding speed at second. The outfield pulled towards right for Reese. At the depth that they are at, a base hit should score Kerry Robinson. Bouncing ball to short. Weiss has it, and that'll do it. So the tying run stranded. The Reds have stranded 6, but the good news is they get 3 of the 7th, 2 in the 8th. It's now a one-run ball game. We're heading to the 9th. Reds have one more crack at them.
Pitcher and Jason LaRue making sure that they're on the same page. 11-6 on the year. 18 saves for Scott and a very nifty 1.8 earned run average. Look at the hits to innings pitched. He has almost doubled up his innings to innings pitch and has more strikeouts than innings. That's why he's one of the leading candidates for Rookie of the Year.
His job right here is keep it where it is and give the Reds a chance in the bottom of 9. Gerald Williams for strike one. Williams 0 for 3 and a walk tonight. A walk his first time up. Lined to left, struck out, and lined a soft liner to third. Waves at the slider, down and away. And it's no balls and two strikes. By the way, that home run by Aaron Boone last inning means another $100 to the United Way from each of our Home Run Derby sponsors, and we thank you. The Mets 7, Houston 3. Robin Ventura doubled in John Olerud. gave 7 runs, 10 hits, no errors. The Reds 6-12-0. The Reds took a 1-0 lead early in this one. 3 straight hits in the first. The last by Casey made it 1-0. Then it was all Atlanta. 2 in the third, 2-run home run by Brett Boone. 5 in the sixth made it 7-1. Capped by a 3-run home run by Brian Hunter. Then the Reds started the comeback. 3 runs in the seventh inning. In that seventh, base hits by Hammonds, LaRue, Sweeney. A walk forced in 1 run, a base hit by Larkin another, and a double play another, and it was 7-4. And then 2 in the eighth, and it's 7-6. Got him.
I'm not so sure that Gerald Williams knows what that pitch was that he just swung at. Sometimes Scott Williamson throws his slider so hard that you really can't tell. But we'll take a look at the home run. Or will we? No, we'll take a look at the strikeout. I like that one better. Nice breaking ball right there after getting ahead of Gerald Williams, and Scott Williamson gets it where he wants it.
Williamson, who usually comes in blowing heat, has used the breaking ball to get the leadoff hitter. Here's Brett Boone, takes it low for a ball. Already completed. San Francisco beat Philadelphia 5-3. Pittsburgh 9, Colorado 8. In the eighth, Milwaukee leads LA 5-4. St. Louis leads Florida 7-0 in the seventh. And we told you about the Mets leading Houston 7-3. Still top of the sixth in the Astrodome. Hit to left. There goes the left fielder Vaughn, but it'll hop over the fence. And Brett Boone continues his red hot series. Boone's third hit tonight. He's 3-for-4 and a walk, and he's in scoring position with an insurance run.
Will somebody make this guy hit a breaking ball, please?
Here comes Chipper Jones, and the Reds will walk him intentionally. That'll set up a possible double play and bring Brian Jordan to the plate. While that happens, we can give you some of the details on those ball games. And the San Francisco win over Philadelphia 5-3. Rodriguez got the win. Gomes took the loss. Jeff Kent hit his 17th, and Ellis Burks hit his 26th for the Giants. And the Pittsburgh win over Colorado 9-8. Sauerbeck the winner, Veers the loser. Klontz picks up a save. Al Martin hit his 23rd home run. Brant Brown, second in two nights, his 13th. Larry Walker hit his 34th. Todd Helton his 28th. Barry his 5th. And Nathan Perez his 11th in those games that are final. In the American League, Cleveland beat Anaheim 8-1. Dave Burba wins his 12th. Washburn the loser. Tomei, 27th home run. Richie Sexton is 26th. Boston beat Kansas City 4-3. Merker the winner. Rosado the loser. Beck gets his first save acquired yesterday from the Cubs. Toronto shut out Minnesota. Escobar the winner. Milton the loser. Pat Borders, just acquired by Toronto yesterday, hit his first home run. Toronto, though, probably lost Joey Hamilton for the year with shoulder trouble. And Baltimore beat Tampa Bay 3-1. Albert Bell hit his 30th in that game. Here, 2 on, 1 out. Brian Jordan to the plate. Jordan doubled his last time up to make it 3-1 back in the fifth.
Scott Williamson looking for a ground ball. Brian Jordan has hit into 7 ground ball double plays on the year.
Down and away. 1-1 in that Mets Astros game right now, going to the bottom of the sixth. 7 runs, 14 hits for the Mets. 3 runs, only 3 hits for the Astros. 3 hits off Octavio Dotel. He's been something the last month. Thank you. the dirt. Great job by LaRue.
Boy, you're not kidding. That ball had getaway all the way to the backstop written all over it. One of those hard spinning sliders. You're not really sure which way it's going to break. You just got to try to get your body in front of it and square up.
Come on, Scotty, let's go. From Jason LaRue. Fastball that the Reds wanted. They don't get it, and it's 3-1. This is one case, Chris, where you throw it 3-1 will be a key. Got him. The way Jordan's swinging the bat with the bad hand, you figure you got to come in on him and you got to come hard.
Well, Scott Williamson right now doesn't look like he's just spotting his fastball. He's just kind of rearing back and cutting it loose, which is when you throw 94 or 95, not a bad idea. Just don't leave it down and out over the middle.
3-2, one out. Will the runners be off? They're not. Jordan sends it to right. Dimitri Young back. Boone's tagging. Dimitri has it. The throw will be cut by Larkin. It'll be first and third.
Good idea by Brett Boone right there. With a guy like Williamson on the mound, his propensity to bounce his slider and bounce that forkball of his, you want to get the third base. A wild pitch will score you. And the Braves are looking for one more bit of insurance.
With two out, that insurance also could be Chipper Jones heading off from first, getting in a rundown and trying to get Boone home. We'll see how the Reds do it. The Reds have already nailed one runner at the plate on a throw through to second. That was thanks to a great throw from Pokey Reese in the series. You don't want to take the bat out of this guy's hands, though. Andrew Jones has been poisoned to the Reds in at 274 in this night. He's already singled in a run to make it 4-1. That was back in the sixth.
Yeah, I think that's a key thing right there. Don't take the bat out of the hands of Andrew Jones and the fact that Brett Boone, not exactly a speedster on third.
There goes Chipper, and they'll just let him go. The Reds won't take a chance.
Well, now what you have is an opportunity, if you don't feel comfortable pitching to Andrew Jones, to pitch to Walt Weiss, who's in the on-deck circle.
In my mind, no-brainer. Walk him.
Weiss is a pretty good clutch hitter. But they are going to take the advice of George Graham.
And what it does, and it sets
really
up,
sets up.
Sure.
Sure it does. I mean, this is sound baseball right here, and Jack McKeon just playing the odds.
Sets up a force at any base, and that'll mean that Klesko will come to the plate. Mm-hmm. It's Williamson against Klesko. So here's the matchup that is the key one of the ball game right now. Bases loaded, Klesko. This is a bench for Bobby Cox now that we've expanded it after the 1st of September that is loaded with seven left-handed bats off the bench and two switch hitters. So it's Klesko against Williamson and a key point in this game. What are you more comfortable with, Andrew Jones against Williamson or Klesko against Williamson? Jack McKeon opting for Klesko against Williamson. They're the Boone brothers at third.
First time matchup between these two guys.
Klesko in at 298. 18 home runs, 68 runs batted in. Bases loaded, two outs. Is throwing strikes.
Well, Scott Williamson came off that mound kind of hard that time. Don Gullett's going to come out and check him out. That he looked like he strained something either in his back or his leg.
Like a groin area as he started to come off. Was it just a tweak or what? Take a look.
Watch him at the very end of this pitch and the follow through right there. Looks like he lands kind of stiff-legged on his left leg, and as he follows through towards first, he turns his ankle a little bit. Apparently he's okay.
intentional walks. The bases loaded with two outs. No place to put Klesko. One ball, no strikes. The Reds have come back from a 7-1 deficit, but in danger right here in the top of the ninth. That's a strike.
He throws two more of those in that same spot. Nothing Klesko can do about it. Perfect spot.
That's why Klesko did not start against Ballone tonight. You see those numbers against left-handers. Rip, but foul by about 6 inches. That might have cleared the bases. Andrew Jones was just about at the dirt cutoff.
A hard breaking ball right in on the hands of Klesko. Shows you how strong he is. Almost kept that ball fair.
One ball, two strikes. Williamson against Klesko. If the Reds have a chance, this is the at-bat they need to win. The two runners advance. It's now 8-6.
Boy, this is a tough pitch for Jason LaRue to kind of get down to. It's a 95-mile-an-hour plus fastball, a little bit of hair on it. He tries to get down there. Isn't sure. It's one of those no-man land situations where you're not sure whether you should backhand the glove or try to slide over to it. He just couldn't get to it in time.
Wild pitch charged to Williamson. It's now 8-6.
Just a case of Scott Williamson just trying to rear back and throw the ball too hard.
That little extra oomph gets him into trouble. Now he's got to still deal with Klesko. It's 2-2. Same spot, and he won't bite on it. It's 3-2.
Your fail-safe here is after the wild pitch that advanced the runners, it opened up a spot at first base.
And Brian Hunter sitting in the on-deck circle.
You're not hurt by a ball four.
Three, two, two outs.
Late on that one. Williamson has the type of fastball that he could go up the ladder against a guy like Ryan Klesko.
And in this at bat, he's come at him one way. In, down and in, down and in, down and in. They're setting up in again. Ball four, bases loaded. Klesko walks, and here comes Brian Hunter, who already tonight has hit a three-run home run, his sixth of the year. Time these two have faced off against each other. Now here's one guy that even at 95 or 96 can catch up to a fastball. So
if it's up in the strike zone,
you have to pitch him intelligently.
And the reason he can catch up to it is that he's a dead red hitter and he'll cheat on it a little bit. So once you establish the fact that you can throw a strike with your fastball, he's a guy that you go after with your breaking ball.
Stay away, down and away. Well, I tell you, LaRue has earned his money just in this inning tonight.
And the way Williamson came off the mound after that pitch, I tell you, I think he's hurt himself out there and just trying to gut it out. Something's not right.
He certainly has not looked comfortable this whole inning. One ball, one strike. And it's 2-1. Dennis Reyes back throwing in the bullpen. Two outs, bases loaded. No place to put this guy. It looked as if Hunter was fooled. He wanted to pull the trigger, couldn't. Jeff Kellogg calls it a ball inside. It's 3-1.
Got to throw him two strikes.
Backing out of play, that might have been ball four. Now 3-2, the runners will release. Having trouble throwing his breaking ball since that first batter in this inning. Do you throw it 3-2?
You can't.
Moving, fouled off, stays 3-2.
Anytime you get into a tough game situation, nearly every pitching coach will say the same thing. You've got to go with your strength regardless of what the hitter's strength is. If you're a fastball pitcher, and that's the pitch you can throw over for a strike, that's the pitch you throw.
3-2, two outs, runners moving. He drills that a mile and a half into the red seats, but foul.
Talk about cheating on a fastball. There's your perfect example of it right there. Why does Brian Hunter catch up with anybody's heater? Well, he gets it going just a little bit quicker than other guys do. I mean, he is opened up and cranking.
Yes, the answer is you throw your best pitch at 3-2, but now three pitches into 3-2. Do you still do it? Guessing game, Williamson and Hunter. Another fastball drilled again into the seats. It's a catch, but boy, he's going to pay the price with the sore hands tomorrow.
An ugly finder.
Looking at him, I don't think he felt that.
No, but his head will hurt tomorrow.
Here's the 3-2 again. Got him. He finally went to the breaking ball. Hunter tuned it up for the fastball, and Williamson gets out of trouble. But Scott Williamson going very slowly off the mound. The Reds need two to tie. Here we go to the bottom of nine.
Williamson, well, as we mentioned, Jordan, we don't think he's right, and he was attended to by the Reds medical team in there. Greg Lynn coming over. He's in some pain right there, it looks like. Could be emotional pain after giving up that one run in the inning, but he limped off the mound after a couple of those pitches, and they're still in there talking to him.
Greg Lynn checking him out to see if he's okay physically or just emotionally drained after that inning. Well, now the work turns to the offense. The Reds trail by 2, 8-6. Here we go to the bottom of the ninth. Barry Larkin tonight, 2 singles, 2 for 4. He kept the Reds rally alive in the seventh with a base hit that knocked in the third run.
Well, that extra run by the Braves, very important right here. The Reds need base runners. One option for Larkin is trying to poke a bunt by John Rocker. As deep as Brett Boone is playing, if you get it on the right side of the infield, you've got a base hit.
The Reds have 33 come-from-behind victories this year. They'll need a 34th to win their first series from the Braves since 1996. 8 runs, 11 hits for Atlanta. 6 runs, 12 hits for Cincinnati. Missing outside. 1 ball and 1 strike. Remember, the length of that inning, Rocker had to sit through all of it after coming on to get the final outs of the eighth inning. Larkin, Casey, Vaughn do up. Barry pops it up into center. Boone back calling. that one away. Time for our Geico Minute, and one of the new Reds joining the roster today, Travis Dawkins. His reaction to Buddy Bell when he was given the news that he was coming up, quote, "I just started smiling, I hugged him, told him that I loved him." He sends you to the majors, you'll love him forever.
Yeah, that sounds like the first line of a hit song.
Travis was saying before the game today, he has so much that he owes Buddy Bell for the time that he spent with him, the talking about what it takes to be a major leaguer, and also to Phil Wellman, his manager the last couple of years. We'll have more in the next few days about Travis Dawkins. You'll get a chance to listen to him and meet him. Right now, on the griddle is Sean Casey. One out, no one on, ninth inning. Casey, single, two walks, and bounced into a double play in the seventh. That came with the bases loaded, knocked in a run. Casey drills it to right, going back. It's going to be gone. Now that run in the top of the ninth looms even bigger. Instead of a tie game at 7-7, it's now 8-7. Number 22 for Sean Casey, and the Reds are within one. That home run by Casey means another $100 to the United Way from each of our Home Run Derby sponsors. Strikeouts, a fly ball out, and he hit into the first double play on a night when the Braves have turned four double plays against the Reds. Those double plays certainly have affected this ball game tonight. 8-7 Atlanta with one out in the ninth. He holds on the slider. It's a ball and a strike.
Boy, on the season, Johnny Rocker's been awfully tough against left-handers, holding them to a batting average of 104. Just a second home run to a lefty he's given up all year long, and it was a big one to Sean.
One ball, one strike to Vaughn. Up high. Vaughn's fly ball in the sixth went to the base of the center field wall, where Andrew Jones hauled it down. Way high, 3-1. Dimitri Young's on deck. No one throwing in the Braves bullpen. The 30 closed man of the Braves, John Rockers, the man that Bobby Cox has entrusted this game to. Here comes Rocker against Vaughn.
Well, he just blew the fastball by Greg Vaughn, probably ball four if he had been able to hold back. But like against Scott Williamson, you've got to get it started just a little bit early against Johnny Rocker.
Third strikeout for Vaughn tonight. Here's another look at Sean Casey's 22nd, our Ohio Lottery replay.
Looked like a pretty good pitch from John Rocker, too. Down, out, over the plate. Sean Casey gets that bat going, stays in there nicely, and gets it done.
Where is it? Vaughn thinks it's ball four. The man who counts, Jeff Kellogg, calls it strike three. And Greg is punched out for the third time tonight. Two of them, questionable calls. Here's a ground ball to short. Weiss has it, and it's over. That's Ozzie Guillen, who came in at short. He ends it, and the Reds fall one run short. Eight runs, 11 hits. hits for the Braves, 7-13-0 for the Reds. That run in the top of the ninth turned out to be decisive. So instead of playing extras, this one ends as Bobby Cox will end the regular season, winning all but one of the nine games between these two teams. 3 hours and 5 minutes of baseball, 23,977 in the big ballpark by the river. Ron Ballone started. Five innings, six hits, five runs allowed. The Reds fell behind 7-1, but rallied with three in the seventh, two in the eighth, one in the ninth. It wouldn't be enough as the Braves come home with the victory. So the Reds will head to Philadelphia, Chris, and depending on what happens in that Houston game, they could be a game and a half back, or they could be two and a half back. Mulholland gets the win 8-7. Ballone takes the loss 7-5. Rocker gets his 31st save. Brett Boone is 17th home run. Brian Hunter is 6th. Aaron Boone is 10th. And Casey is 22nd.
Well, the good news, George, if you're going to look for a silver lining, is the Braves are getting on an airplane and heading out of town. They're not going to see the Reds again unless the Reds make it the postseason. So they'll have to take that big road show on the road where they've had a lot of success on the season.
So Atlanta wins it here by a final score of 8-7. Reminder, we'll be back on the air from Philadelphia on Friday at 7 o'clock. Steve Parris against Curt Schilling. For Chris Welch, our entire crew, this is George Grant. Good night, everybody. See you at the ball.